Recorded Books presents The Raconteur's Commonplace Book by Phineas Amalgam. Edited by Kate Milford. Narrated by Jonathan Todd Ross. Chapter 1. The Blue Vein Tavern. The rain had not stopped for a week, and the roads that led to the inn were little better than rivers of muck. This, at least, is what Captain Frost said when he tramped indoors, coated in the yellow mud peculiar to that part of the city, before hollering for his breakfast. The rest of the guests sighed. Perhaps today, they had thought. Perhaps today their unnatural captivity would end. But the bellowing man calling for eggs and burnt toast meant that, for another day at least, 15 people would remain prisoners of the river Skidwrack, and the new rivers that had once been roads, and the rain. They passed the day much as they had passed the day before, and the day before that. Eventually, Mr. Haypotton, the innkeeper, announced supper in half an hour. He apologized for the state of the meals and the flickering lights, but without real worry. The Haypottons might run out of provisions eventually, but they had not kept this inn and tavern on the Skidwrack for a quarter of a century and more without seeing a flood or two, and they were well prepared for the whims of the river and the rain. The electricity might flicker and the hot water heating system, bought by the previous owners off an itinerant salesman when Mr. Haypotton was still in short pants, had never worked properly, but since the inn's fireplaces never went dark, its rooms never went particularly cold. Nobody would freeze, nobody would starve, and as for the rising water, "See that?" Mr. Haypotton would say, opening one of the windows in the lounge barroom against the cold and wet and pointing across the porch that wrapped halfway around the inn to indicate a blue step in the stairway leading down to the river. "That's where the river came back in 15. She doesn't dare come nearer than that. Water won't rise past a blue stair. Isn't that so, Captain?"
"That's so, Marcus,"
Captain Frost agreed today, as he had every day, because Mr. Haypotton kept the captain in very good sherry. But when Mr. Haypotton left the lounge to go help his wife and the kitchen maid finish preparing supper, the captain sang a different tune. Captain Frost's eyes were deep-lined, his face tanned to mahogany, and his hair and beard bleached to a yellowed bone color from his decades at sea. He felt himself, not inaccurately, to be somewhat an expert in weather lore, and when the innkeeper was out of earshot, he muttered that he'd never heard such doss before in his life, oh, years at sea, and if painting a thing blue were all it took to put water in its place, then how was it every ship in the harbor wasn't sky-colored? Then he finished his very good sherry, pulled on his coat, and stumped into the hall and back out to check the weather and the roads yet again, as he did at every turn of the cracked half-hourglass he tended as religiously as if he were still aboard ship. It was never far from his elbow when he was inside the house, though it meant rearranging the place settings a bit at meals. He left 4 guests behind in the lounge. Jessamy Butcher got up from her chair by the window, where she could see how very close the water was actually coming to the much-discussed blue stair, went around the bar and found the captain's bottle of sherry. She poured herself a glass, then held the bottle up in one thin gloved hand, offering it silently to the rest of the room. The tattooed young man named Negret declined and went back to the pages he had taken from the pockets of his tweed vest and was stacking together on the bar top, a mismatched collection of liquor labels, scraps of newsprint, wallpaper, remnants of the long, match-like twists of paper called spills that the maid kept in vases in each room for lighting the lamps and fires around the inn, and other scavenged oddments. When he had them where he wanted them, he took a sharp, round-handled awl from a roll of tools that lay open on the countertop before him, and, pressing the pages flat with his palm, began to poke holes along one edge. But his brother, Reaver, nodded in response to Jessamy's offer, and murmured his thanks as she reached across the bar to pass him a glass. Jessamy tried once again to decide whether or not the pale brick-haired Colophon brothers were identical under their facial decorations. It was impossible to say. The tattoos were very similar, but not quite the same. Plus, Negret wore his hair long and floppy, while Reaver kept his short-cropped and cowlicky. And one didn't like to be rude by looking too long. Jessamy turned to the fourth person in the room. Mr. Tessarian? At his table across the lounge, Al Tessarian looked up from his half-built castle of playing cards. Dear God, yes. No, my dear, don't bother, he said as Jessamy made a motion to come around the bar. Be right there. He placed a card and got up. The other three held a collective breath, but Tessarian's castles didn't dare fall until he gave them permission, which was generally done by calling Maisie, the youngest guest, to do the honors. Then and only then, when Maisie had pulled away a queen or gusted a sharp breath onto an ace, they toppled spectacularly, cards flying in all directions as if the laws of physics held no sway in the realm to which they truly belonged. Tessarian accepted his glass with a bow, then returned to his architecture. He paused on his way to look at Negret's handiwork. Binding another book? Negret nodded as he lifted the stack of papers and held the edge he'd perforated up to the light, checking to be sure the holes were lined up the way he wanted. It needs covers, Tessarian observed. He felt inside one sleeve, frowned, then took off the battered and narrow-brimmed pork-pie hat he wore at all times except meals. From inside the lining he produced a pair of aces and tossed them on the bar. Will those do? Negret added the cards to a stack, one on top and one on the bottom. Perfectly, if you can spare them. Tessarian laughed. An old gambler always has a couple of spare aces someplace. Elsewhere in the inn, Petra, the guest who had been there the longest, borrowed from the maid a key to one of the countless glass cases that occupied walls and corners all around the inn, so that she and Maisie could take down one of Mrs. Haypotton's music boxes, very carefully wind it, and dance for a bit. Maisie Sarah Harrow was young, and had been traveling alone to meet the aunt who was taking her in, with no luggage but an old ditty bag that held everything she owned. Each day someone said something along the lines of, "Won't your auntie be relieved when she gets here and sees that you're safe?" Most often that someone was Mrs. Haypotton, who had a habit of misplacing her spectacles, or her ring of keys, or her best little sewing scissors, and was never quite sure what, other than "thank you," she ought to say when Maisie inevitably found them for her, no matter in what unlikely place they'd been. Flummoxed, she always came out with something like, "Won't your auntie be so happy to see what a nice, polite, helpful girl you are when she gets here, dear?" Petra, however, never said anything like that. Not even when Maisie found the dragonfly-shaped hair clip she had lost at breakfast 2 days before, half hidden by the hem of one of the dining room curtains. Petra instead went for a key and a music box, because the unspoken truth was that, given the volume of rain and the slope of the hills, if Auntie had been on the roads at the wrong time, she was never coming, and Maisie was a girl, not a fool. But when that girl danced, sending her short, sleek, dark hair fluttering and the pleated skirt of her jumper frock swishing around her knees, her face lost its fear. And Mrs. Haypotton had an improbable collection of music boxes, 41 that Petra and Maisie had managed to count, no two of which, as far as they could determine, played the same song. Today, with the dragonfly back in its customary place among Petra's dark-bobbed curls, they picked one from the tall cabinet in the parlor, which, like the lounge, looked out over the riverfront. The cabinet had the thick, bubble-pocked green glass that was the only sort that could be made from Nag's Peak sand, and Mrs. Haypotton had told them it held some of her favorite pieces, so they took extra care. Maisie chose a music box shaped like a kite, with a terrifyingly delicate-looking ceramic key. She wound it gently, the eggshell-colored winder stark against the brown of her fingers. When she set it down and lifted the lid, it took a few notes before the tune resolved itself into Riverward. Maisie hummed along as she spun in a wide-armed circle, swirling her shawl behind her as she turned, making the embroidered chrysanthemums upon it float in the air. Sullivan, the young man who'd been sitting in a chair facing the fire, his eyes glazing over as they stared up at the big antique map that hung above the mantel, shoved himself abruptly to his feet and hurried out, briefly grasping Petra's wrist in apology as he stumbled past. That was unusual enough to make Petra look after him curiously. In the 7 days since he'd arrived, Petra had never seen Sullivan do anything without an almost eerie sort of grace. He was so implausibly elegant when he moved, and so bloody good-looking to boot, that it was hard to believe he wasn't a hallucination. Petra had had to stop herself more than once from sticking him with a pin as he crossed a room, just to see if then, finally, he'd make a misstep. But apparently, all it took was Riverward. Interesting. The old woman in the corner, thinner even than Jessamy Butcher, rocked her chair gently in time with the song as the music box wound down. Her skin, like Maisie's and Petra's both, was dark, but ruddy here and grayish there, uneven and slightly pocked, while Maisie had the clear and perfect skin of a child, and Petra the kind of faultless complexion it would have taken a motion picture actress an hour in makeup to achieve. The lady they all called Madame Grisaille spoke little, but she hummed as she rocked. It wasn't a loud sound. If the hot water coils in the cast-iron case mounted on the wall across the room happened to be sizzling at the same time a wind rattled the windows, the hum was almost impossible to hear. But Petra and Maisie could feel it like a thrum in their bones as they danced, as if Madame's tune flowed through her and into the very boards, the very nails in the floor, and back up through their feet so that it could sway with them. "Madame is a dancer," Maisie had whispered to Petra the first time she had noticed this. "When she was younger, you think?" Petra had whispered back. This had been 3 days ago, one evening when they were all on their way into the dining room, where Madame was always seated first out of unspoken respect for what? For her age, perhaps, or for her stateliness? If watching Sullivan was like watching a mirage that was too beautiful to be real, watching Madame was like watching a queen, trying badly to disguise what she was, too regal for her sham ordinariness to be believed. "No," Maisie had replied softly, "not just when she was younger. Now, she's a dancer. She wants to dance when we do, but she holds herself back." "Why would she do that?" "I don't know." But the girl's eyes had begun to glow. "Maybe it's a secret? That she's a dancer is a secret?" "No." Maisie had looked thoughtfully at Madame as she followed Petra to the sideboard, where a buffet supper had been laid out, and where Maisie had found a tortoiseshell button that had gone missing from Mrs. Haypotton's house dress earlier that day. "But she has a secret, so she doesn't dance, because you can't dance and hide who you are." Petra had thought that this was a very wise observation, and said so. She had also thought that if dancing showed one for who she was, Maisie danced like someone with no secrets to keep. That idea made her smile. But she hadn't wanted to make Maisie feel self-conscious, and sometimes the girl's dancing revealed as plainly as tears that she was carrying something that, when she remembered it, made her very, very sad. So Petra kept her thoughts to herself. Today, Madame Grisaille hummed along with Riverward and then Gaslight, which was the tune plinked out by Maisie's favorite music box, a chrysanthemum-shaped one that nearly matched the flowers on her shawl. Then another new thing, as if Sullivan tripping over himself hadn't been strange enough. As the sun began to set across the river and the chrysanthemum played its last slow notes, Madam stopped rocking. She reached into the white fur hand muff she always carried with her, even indoors, and took a new music box out of it. This one was plainer at first glance, just a round box of gold and ceramic with a scene painted on the lid. She raised one finger to her lips and then began to wind it. There was something so secretive about the motion, Petra instinctively checked to be sure both the parlor door and the French doors to the porch were closed, and that the three of them were alone.
"This one is from my room upstairs," Madame murmured in a voice gravelly with age. "I don't know that Mrs. Haypotton would be comfortable with my carrying it about, so we shall keep this between ourselves. But it plays a remarkable song."
She finished winding, held it out on one spread hand, and lifted the lid. Maisie turned her head sideways, trying to make sense of the now upside-down painting on the lid. Two people sitting at a finger post, perhaps? But only for a second, because when the song began, it was everything the girl's dancer's heart could have wished for from a piece of music. It was joy and love and exquisite pain. It was danger and the thrill of adventure, and the certainty of failure and the thrum of hope. It was dream and nightmare. It was flight. It was winter and summer and water and stone and metal and fire and earth, and Maisie danced as she had never imagined dancing before. After a moment, Madame handed the music box to Petra, and at last, perhaps because it was only the three of them in the room, the old woman joined the young girl, and they danced together hand in hand. And suddenly, Maisie understood why Madame had refused to dance before. And she knew what the old woman's secret was, too, and she understood the knowledge for the gift it was, and wrapped her arms around it, concealing it in swirling embroidered chrysanthemums as the two of them whirled together, both dancing now like people with no secrets to keep, as the sunset over the river painted them in golden light, orange light, crimson light. Madame caught Petra's eye over the girl's head, and the two women smiled at each other. Perhaps the notes found their way out through cracks in the windows, drifted on the rainy wind along the length of the porch facing the skid rack, and snuck back into the house through another chipped pane of glass in a different room altogether. Perhaps they had other ways of making themselves heard. Either way, beyond the hall, beyond the stairs, two people in the lounge heard the song too. Negret Colophon, stitching an elaborate binding into his scrap paper book, dropped his needle in surprise, then quickly picked it up again and pretended not to have heard anything. Jessamy Butcher, who had been deep in conversation with Reaver Colophon a short way down the bar, was less subtle. Her head turned so quickly in the direction of the music that several joints in her neck and shoulders cracked. The popping might even have been audible had her gloved fingers not at the same moment crushed her sherry-glassed fragments and powder. Reaver, who had been debating just then whether it was time to invite Miss Butcher to continue their conversation in a more private corner of the inn, jerked back as glass and liquor flew. Jessamy did not appear to have noticed what she had done.
"Remarkable," she said in tones of quiet wonder, ignoring his stare, along with those of Negret from a few seats away, and Tessarian from the table with the card castle.
"What is?" Reaver asked.
"That song," Jessamy breathed out, a strange huff that wasn't quite a sigh.
Reaver looked back down at the bar top between them, and saw that she still clutched pieces of the glass she had destroyed. He took her hands in his and gently uncurled her fingers.
One by one, he removed the shards carefully from her palms, where small spots of blood had begun to seep through her pristine pink gloves. Then he held her hand for a moment when he had finished, watching her face. She did not appear to notice any of this, and he could hear no song. After a moment, Jessamy took her hands back and got to her feet. Self-consciously, she tucked a stray bit of hair into place and smoothed it back with her palm, a gesture that left a small rose-tinted streak among the pale blonde finger waves over her ear. She walked out of the lounge and across the hall, then slipped into the parlor. Petra and Madame looked over sharply, but when Jessamy closed the door behind her, they relaxed. The song, improbably, had not yet begun to slow.
"Do you want to dance, too?" Maisie asked,
reaching for the newcomer's hand, ignoring the blood that marked Jessamy's gloved palm like stigmata.
Jessamy spun Maisie around by the fingers that held hers, but her feet stood firm on the floor as she shook her head. "I don't dance," she said with a smile. "But I know that song well. I tried to play it once, but it's more difficult than it sounds. I was a musician, you know. Long ago, back in another lifetime."
Musician or not, Miss Butcher is a dancer too, thought Maisie, who could always tell. I wonder what her secret is. There were six other people at the Blue Vein. The Haypottons, of course, and Sorcha, the maid, who was 16, plump and black-eyed, and utterly smitten with Negret Colophon, a thing that had shocked everyone who'd realized it, because in the same inn there was Sullivan, whose face was so perfect it would have been blinding, except for that tiny scar he wore under one eye. But Sorcha, like Maisie, was a girl, not a fool, and she sensed unerringly that there was danger in that much beauty. And even though he wasn't precisely what you'd call handsome, there was something about Mr. Negret, with his face obscured by the swirling pattern of dotted tattoos, that made her need to look closer, to sneak surreptitious glances whenever she came across him looking through the books on the shelves in the lounge, or the atlases on the mantel in the parlor, or the decades' accumulation of assorted bound material that stuffed the corner bookcase where the stairs turned midway between the first and second floors. Not to mention that when he thought no one was paying attention, he sang under his breath, as he pieced his paper scraps together into hand-stitched tomes or stood at a window, reading by whatever light managed to filter in through the rain. But of course, in an inn, the maid at least is almost always listening. And more than once, when she went around at night to bank the inn's fires after everyone else had gone to sleep, Sorcha had caught herself singing the words of the fire-keeping prayer she'd learned from her mother's father, to the tune she'd gotten from Negret. The last three guests were in the public bar at the front of the inn, where they were allowed to smoke. There was Antony Massiter, a tall traveling merchant whose right eye was green as a cat's and whose left was hidden by a rust-colored patch. Mr. Massiter had a round, dappled scar like a firework on one palm, and appeared to suffer from insomnia that drove him to wander the halls of the inn at night. Between his light footsteps and the rain, he was almost soundless, but Sorcha and one or two of the others had caught glimpses of him. When nightmares or thirst or the need for a bathroom or the fear of the fires going out or something else had driven them out into the halls in the darkling hours. Three nights ago, when Petra had caught him at it, Mr. Massiter had given himself away with music. As she'd been returning to her room, she'd caught a faraway, barely audible spill of tiny notes from somewhere down on the first floor of the inn. High Away, the song played by a red casket on the bottom shelf of the glass cabinet in the parlor. Petra had paused at her door, trying to remember whether she had given the key back to Sorcha after she and Maisie had finished with the music boxes in that cabinet earlier in the evening. She glanced over her shoulder to where Sullivan was frowning in his own doorway. Their eyes met.
"Massiter,"
he had whispered so quietly that only the sibilants were audible.
"He's always up late."
He nodded to the door of the next chamber down the hall to the right.
"I hear him go out."
Then he'd touched his fingers to his lips, not quite a blown kiss, and disappeared into his room. Sullivan, as Sorcha could have told everyone, did not sleep either. She'd heard him later that same night, pacing in his chamber when she passed on her way from her own tiny room to the kitchen to sing the fire-keeping prayer as she checked the stove to be sure it hadn't gone out. Sorcha usually slept soundly, but something about all this rain gave her nightmares. The peddler who'd sold the hot water system half a century ago hadn't had the parts on hand to heat every room in the inn, and he'd never come back in all those years to finish the job. Not to mention, the system had to be stoked up every morning anyhow, to sizzle and knock what heat it did give to the rooms that had coils. Sorcha's banked fires kept well overnight, but lately she woke up twice, sometimes three times a night, in a panic about the fires. So twice, sometimes three times a night, she tied her apron over her nightgown and went around the inn, checking every stove and fireplace she could get to without disturbing a sleeping guest. No, Sullivan did not sleep, but at least he stayed in his room, unlike Mr. Massiter, who had scared her half out of her skin the first time she'd come upon him staring into one of Mrs. Haypotton's hallway display cases, as if he couldn't remember how he'd gotten there. Now she knew to expect him in the corridors, but that didn't make it any less shocking when she came across him suddenly in the dead of the night. He walked like a cat. In the light of day, however, even at sunset, Massiter was ordinary. Today, after Haypotton popped into the public bar to announce supper and popped out again, the traveling merchant offered a pocket box of small cigars to the other two men sharing the room. Phineas Amalgam, a freckled and salt and red pepper-haired neighbor of the Haypottons, who'd come the day the rain had started just to borrow a box of matches, and had wound up stuck there along with the travelers. And an artisan printmaker called Gregory Sanguine, with darker gray hair and skin the color of a wash of good walnut ink on fine Kresik paper, an acquaintance of Amalgam's who had come to stay at the inn on his recommendation. Sanguine's usual work was printing delicate, detailed pictures and illustrations from carved wooden blocks. And he amused himself by crafting small animals out of wood that found their way to Maisie every night at dinner. This had become a joint effort between himself and Sorcha, who saved all the smallish bits of firewood she came across and passed them to Mr. Sanguine, who, once he'd magicked them into beasts and birds with his inlaid whittling knife, passed them back to the maid. At supper, the creatures turned up on Maisie's plate, in her napkin, even in her soup, on the day Mr. Sanguine had turned a longish splinter into a swimming dragon. Today, the printmaker squinted through his pince-nez at a tiny seabird with outstretched wings that he was busy carving from a scrap of pear wood. Maisie's animal, a river otter, already sat finished beside his cup. The bird was meant as a thank you to his co-conspirator. He looked up, blinked, and accepted one of Massiter's cigars.
"Thanks."
"Albatross?" Massiter guessed.
Sanguine nodded.
"For the maid. She's a good sport passing along the little girl's critters."
The cigar temporarily forgotten, he lifted the bird, squinted at it, and touched the point of his knife to a tiny hole in one wing to cut away a nearly invisible splinter.
"Perhaps Mrs. Haypotton will have a spare bit of ribbon it can hang from."
Phineas Amalgam stood staring down at a small card house that Al Tessarian had built on one of the bar tables the night before, and that was somehow still standing. He accepted a cigar, but tucked it in his vest pocket rather than lighting it.
"I'll go ask her, shall I?"
"Good of you, Mr. A," said Sanguine.
"Think nothing of it," Amalgam said. "Sorch is a good egg. Known her since she was a tot."
He nodded his thanks to Massiter and left the parlor. Later, as they all drifted into the dining room, he passed a length of blue velvet ribbon to Sanguine. Mrs. Haypotton, bustling through a moment later, paused to squeeze the printmaker's elbow and murmur, "So kind." And as everyone else was smiling at Maisie's delight at discovering the river otter peeking out of a bread roll, Sanguine tucked the albatross on its ribbon into the maid's hand. After supper, as they had done every other night, the guests moved into the parlor for coffee and tea beside one of Sorch's well-kept fires. It was Phineas Amalgam who, on the evening of that seventh day of floods, suggested the stories. In more civilized places, when travelers find themselves sharing a fire and a bottle of wine, they sometimes choose to share something of themselves, too, Finn told them, as he settled into his favorite chair, one of three that stood before the hearth. And then, wonder of wonders, no strangers remain. Only companions, sharing a hearth and a bottle. Mr. Haypotton, laying out the coffee on the sideboard, winked at his wife, who held the teapot. Amalgam, a folklorist, made his living collecting tales and putting them into books, so perhaps the innkeeper was thinking that his neighbor's suggestion had a bit of self-service to it. And it might have been that he was right. Still, it was a way to pass the time. The wind and rain rattled the window panes and the French doors as the folks gathered in the parlor looked from one to the next. The young girl in her embroidered silk stole, the twin gentlemen with the tattooed faces, the gaunt woman with her nervous gloved hands constantly moving, the other woman, gaunter still and hidden beneath two layers of voluminous shawls, whose red-brown skin showed in small flashes when her wraps did not quite move along with her, the gambler in his old pork-pie hat, building a castle on the floor before the fire with a pocket full of dice and at least six decks of cards, not counting the strays planted here and there about his person, the captain lurking by the sideboard, where he'd stowed the half-hour glass and was itching to turn it, but was also thinking it would be rude to interrupt Amalgam or get in the way of the Haypottons as they worked, the printmaker smoking Massiter's cigar by one of the windows overlooking the river, the young man with the perfection and the scar, and the young woman with the dragonfly in her dark, curly hair, sitting just far enough from him on the sofa that the arm he had stretched out along the top of it did not touch her shoulder. And the gap between them, where Maisie had been before she had gone to sit beside Tessarion on the floor to help build the castle. The maid beside the door to the hallway, who must be counted here, because no one who sings prayers set to stolen music when she works at a fire can be left as mere set dressing in a tale. And the merchant, leaning on the mantel, toying with the filigree on the big music box that lived there, a case the size of a loaf of bread, which stood open to reveal a beautiful tree wrought of several kinds of metal, with roots entangled among the device's gears. "If you will listen," Phineas Amalgam said, swirling his glass, "I will tell the first tale. Then, perhaps, if you find it worth the trade, you will give me one of yours."
"Hear, hear!"
Mr. Haypotton passed Amalgam a cup of coffee. "Let's have a good one, Finn."
"Could you tell the one about the house in the pines?" Petra asked.
Amalgam glanced at her, surprised.
"I read it in one of your books," she explained.
Oh, the folklorist had collected hundreds of stories into books. It was perhaps not terribly surprising that he did not immediately remember that the story Petra had asked for was not actually in any of them.
"Yes, I suppose I could tell that one.
It can be hard to keep one's stories straight."
"Thank you," said Petra.
Unable to restrain himself any longer, Captain Frost turned the half-hour glass, and Phineas Amalgam said again, "Listen." Chapter 2. The Game of Maps. The Folklorist's Tale. "Listen. There was a city that could not be mapped, and inside it a house that could not be drawn. It stood at the bottom of a hill on a street called Fellwool, a lane with broken pavement that had been overgrown and mostly hidden by ancient, knotty pines. It was the kind of house that, in simpler times, might have been called enchanted, or haunted, or cursed. These houses appear now and then in towns and cities that will tolerate them. Sometimes they survive, sometimes they do not. This house, the house in which this tale takes place, had survived for many, many years. It had copper pipes that reached down into the earth like roots. Its woodwork had taught its stonework how to breathe in exchange for lessons in strength, and the ironwork that chased the eaves and climbed the walls and curled along the windows danced in the sunset. It allowed its rooms to roam like cats. It had permitted residents now and then, when the endless march of the years got lonely, but it never kept them long. It was a crafty dwelling, and it had ways of regaining its solitude when visitors overstayed their welcome. A truth I have noticed, I believe it's a truth at any rate, is that the extraordinary calls to the extraordinary. Over time, little by little, spoon by spoon, and cup by clock, one cupboard and one key and one battered hat at a time, this singular house collected things to it. Things remarkable and peculiar and marvelous and uncanny. When the house was occupied, this led to occasional, let us call them adventures. Although by adventures, I don't mean only the cheerful and happily ending sort of occurrences. When it was empty, the house and its collection of wonderful and terrible furnishings whispered to one another. What happened this time? Well, I'll tell you. It was wonderful. Or, it was terrible. Sometimes people ventured in uninvited. The house and its denizens dealt with this in different ways, depending. Much of that community was inclined to be more curious than annoyed, but some of the rooms were antisocial or easily insulted or worse, and some of the furnishings had questionable senses of humor or were inclined toward troublemaking or were simply malicious. The house itself came to dislike visitors, simply because they caused so many tensions between the spaces and items the structure contained. Eventually, it began to really discourage intruders, both for their own good and to keep the peace. And, to limit the amount of damage, sometimes there was fallout when the more malevolent rooms and objects really got going, and the tools and brooms and mops in the house resented being made to clean up everyone else's messes. One autumn, a man came to town. Though he was a peddler by trade, he was in town that year not to sell but to acquire. The peddler had lost a thing belonging to his employer, and he had been tasked with the almost impossible duty of replacing the mechanism in question. The first of the many arcane pieces the reconstruction required was among the most important. A keyhole. Not a key, not a lock, but the actual keyway belonging to a particular sort of cabinet. The sort that formed an added gate, which is a technical term for what you might otherwise call a portal. And not just any portal, but the sort of portal that could bridge space and time. For the mechanism the peddler was attempting to build had to be able to manipulate both. The peddler had traveled widely, and in his travels, he'd read tales of this sort of portal. Added gates hidden in wardrobes and in looking glasses, in clocks, in wells, in bed knobs, but it wasn't every building that would tolerate the presence of border furniture within its walls. Buildings, after all, are mostly meant to keep the world out, not let other worlds in. And though he was a foreigner, he knew the city of Nag's Peak well. And he suspected that if such a thing as an added gate was to be found there at all, it would be found in the peculiar house on the pine-choked street. So the peddler went in search of a child, because while it is very difficult for an adult to pass through an adit gate, or even find one in the first place, children, especially the right sort of children, fall through them into other worlds all the time. It wasn't long before he happened upon a small boy being ganged up on by a group of bigger boys who, conveniently, were giving him hell for being gutless. The peddler didn't catch what the boy called Panton had done to deserve this, but he wasted no time in coming to the child's defense. "I bet he's braver than you," the peddler said, hauling the loudest of the bullies away by his collar. "Let him prove he's not a coward."
"How?"
the bully snarled, trying unsuccessfully to twist out of the peddler's grip.
"Yes, how?" Panton asked, curious.
The peddler thrust the bully away. "Let him stay a night in the house on Fellwool Street. I'll wager none of the rest of you would dare it." They all shrank back at this suggestion. Everyone knew the house on Fellwool was cursed, but poor Panton was trapped. If he refused, he would be shown to be a coward, provably and perpetually. On the other hand, if he did it, he would be a legend. And so he agreed, because while small children are all prone to beastliness, to some degree or other, they are also all capable of moments of most extraordinary courage. That night, Panton snuck out of his house with a lantern and a satchel full of supplies, and he met the other boys at the end of Fellwool Street. They walked over the broken pavement and through the twisted trees to the house, with Panton, who figured he'd better start looking for his courage now, leading the way. Soon they saw lights in the thick darkness up ahead, candles glowing in the windows of the house. They found the peddler waiting on the porch. One side of the French front door was open, and through it they could see a cluster of lamps and candlesticks standing on a table in the center of the room beyond. The other boys hung back, leaving Panton to climb the porch stairs alone. "I thought I could offer some help, since it was I who got you into this," the peddler said. "A night is a long stretch unless you have some way to pass the time."
"What sort of way?" Panton asked, entranced by the dancing shadows inside the house.
"A treasure hunt," the peddler said, and Panton looked at him at last. His eyes were blue and cold, even in the darkness.
"And if you find the treasure and bring it out to me when your night is up, I'll pay you for it."
The boy's knees knocked.
"What's the treasure, then?"
"Inside this house," the peddler said, "there will be an adit gate. Let's say a sort of cabinet that, when opened, shows you something other than the inside of it. That is the adit gate. It might be part of any sort of cabinet, big or small, old or new. It might be locked, in which case you may try this." And from his pocket, he took a skeleton key. "Take care not to drop it." Panton took it carefully. It was pale where it wasn't marred by red and orange rust streaks, and it was rough to the touch, like unglazed china. "When you find the right cabinet," the peddler continued, "do not go into it, no matter what you might see. The treasure I want is the keyhole from that cabinet." He handed Panton a rolled piece of oilcloth, inside of which the boy felt long, thin shapes. These might be useful, or then again, they might not. Panton stowed the peddler's skeleton key and the rolled cloth inside his pack, took a deep, deep breath, and stepped past the peddler and across the threshold.
"Thank you for lighting the candles."
The man's cold confidence wavered. "I didn't light them." The door swung shut between them before the boy could reply. The moment it banged closed, all the lights, the ones on the table as well as the candle in Panton's own lantern, flared a deep blue. Then they blinked out, and he was swallowed by the dark. He fumbled in his bag for matches as he lurched across the room. He struck a light and reached for the nearest candle, only to find his little flame casting its meager glow onto an empty table thick with dust that didn't look as though it had been disturbed in a very long time. He still had his lantern, of course, and it lit without trouble, burning a perfectly ordinary flame. Panton swallowed his nerves, lifted the lamp with an unsteady hand, and set out to explore the house and find the peddler's mysterious cabinet. From somewhere in the darkness came the ticking of clocks. But there was no furniture in the big foyer except the dusty table. Opposite the front door, a sweeping curved staircase led up to the next floor. There was a single doorway in each wall, the front door he'd come in through, and three wide entrances leading to rooms to his right, to his left, and straight ahead, the last of which was tucked under the curve of the big stair. Through the half-open pocket door to the left, he could just make out the vague shapes of furniture. That room, he thought, might also contain the source of the ticking. Through the arch that gave into the room on the right, Panton's straining eyes, beginning to adjust, picked out the shadows of large, unmoving animal forms. He bolted instinctively for the arch under the stairs. This led him through a dining room to a swinging door that deposited him into a hallway, which in turn took him to the kitchens. There, at last, the boy found cupboards to try. Some were empty and some were not, but everything he found inside each of the cabinets, cutlery, glassware, mismatched china, seemed ordinary. Even the empty ones seemed only ordinarily empty. The kitchen had three other doors in it. Panton chose a set of narrow, paired shutters that he thought probably led into a larder. He opened one and found himself looking into the foyer again, as if through the front door. There before him was the dusty table, and beyond that, the big, curved stair and the arch to the dining room below it. This should have been impossible, and yet there he was. Panton glanced back over his shoulder. If he was, by some weird miracle, now looking through the front door, then the driveway and Felwell Street ought to be just as weirdly and miraculously behind him. But no. There was the kitchen, right where he'd left it. Flummoxed, he stepped through into the foyer and closed the door behind him. He turned to open it again, and instead of the kitchen, there was the outdoors and the dark circular drive. Out in the middle of it, the other boys had built a fire. Panton shut the door with a shaking hand and leaned against the wood, breathing heavily. Was it possible he had found the cabinet the peddler had told him of so quickly? He didn't remember having seen a keyhole on the shutter doors, but then he hadn't been looking for one. He ran across the foyer again and through the room behind the stairs. But this time the back hallway beyond the dining room took him not to the kitchen, but to a narrow set of steep steps that seemed as if it couldn't possibly exist without intersecting with the big sweeping staircase opposite the front door. And, just as unsettlingly, there was light up there. Panton retraced his steps and found himself in a billiard room where the dining room had been. The boy dropped to his haunches and covered his face with his hands. Then he started to laugh. Did every door in this place lead to something other than what logically ought to be behind it? If so, did he just need to find any keyhole at all? The laugh trailed off after a moment, and Panton whispered, "Cabinets," into his palms. The peddler had asked for the keyhole from a cabinet, and anyway, Panton had all night. He stood up and wiped his face. Now that this space was a game room, there were cabinets to try. A sideboard with dusty bottles, a shallow case on the wall that hid a dartboard, a box of dry and flaking cigars, and another of fragrant matches. But none of them turned up anything interesting. And there was a set of double doors covered by curtains. "Onward, then," Panton murmured, stepping through into a towering glass-ceilinged solarium full of dead and decomposing plants. There was a barrister bookcase, its shelves protected by glass, but it held no surprises, just gardening tools. Folded paper envelopes of dried seeds, a pair of notebooks, and a broken pencil. A cuckoo clock hung on the wall beside the door. Panton dragged a chair over, took it down, and opened the back. He jumped as a live bird, red and green, hopped out, stretched its wings, and fluttered away to disappear down the hall. This was odd, certainly, and just as oddly the clock was empty of workings. But the inside of the case was square and wooden and perfectly matched to the outside, and anyhow there was no lock or keyhole on it. Just a simple hook-shaped latch. He rehung the clock and climbed down, then picked his way through wicker furniture and broken plant pots to the glass-paned French doors across the room. He cleaned a grimy pane with spit and his sleeve and peered out. There, beyond the hedges enclosing an overgrown garden, he saw the drive that led to Felwell Street again. Which didn't make sense because the solarium hadn't been visible from the lane. Logically, then, the solarium ought to have been at the back of the house, not the front. But there were the boys, sitting around their fire. And farther on, a smaller glow flared and dimmed. A cigarillo, perhaps, in the hands of the peddler with the cold blue eyes. Panton went to the bookcase for the writing supplies he'd seen earlier. One of the notebooks had barely been used. He flipped past a few sketches of plants and accompanying notes to a blank page, and in a half-hearted attempt to make sense of the confusion of rooms and doors, tried to draw the layout of the house. But there was no way, on the two-dimensional surface of the paper, that he could puzzle together a logical arrangement of the spaces he'd passed through so far. He gave up on that, and began making rough drawings of each room, each on its own page, along with each entrance and exit he'd seen and where they'd taken him. Then he tucked notebook and pencil into his satchel, returned to the doors that had shown him the back garden with its overgrown hedges, and walked through them. Instead of stepping outside, he arrived in the kitchen by way of the paired pantry doors. And so the night passed. Panton was never certain that he explored the whole of the first floor. He looked through whatever space he found himself in, a library, a salon stuffed with taxidermied animals both familiar and strange, a music room, a parlor full of ticking clocks that asserted, ridiculously but with perfectly synchronized chimes, that he'd been in the house for less than 15 minutes. In each room he opened everything that would open. Instrument cases, Davenport desks, chiffon robes, curios, tea chests, case clocks. He sketched each room in the gardener's notebook. Sometimes the red and green bird appeared, fluttering overhead and disappearing through a doorway. Sometimes, instead of a new room, the house deposited him into the hallway that ended at the bottom of the narrow staircase with a spill of light at the top. But at last, Panton began to notice a pattern. Different kinds of entrances led to others that were similar. If he went through a set of French doors, he would emerge through French doors. So from the solarium he could get to the kitchen by way of the pantry, the game room by way of its curtained doors, or the foyer by way of the front entryway. Open entrances led to other open entrances, so he could get from the foyer to any room that also had at least one open, doorless entryway. Pocket doors led only to rooms that also had pocket doors, though that category appeared to include any kind of sliding panel, which Panton discovered by leaving the music room through a pocket door only to find himself tumbling out of a dumbwaiter into a bedroom whose window, when he looked out of it, peered down on the solarium from an upper floor. That bedroom, in turn, deposited him back on the first floor when he tried to leave through its door. Therefore, the boy concluded, what floor a room was on mattered less than what kind of doors it possessed. 9 times out of 10, any entrance he passed through took him somewhere he didn't expect. The peddler had said he wanted the keyhole of a cabinet. But would a keyhole from a door suffice? But no. None of the interior doors appeared to have any locking mechanisms at all. Panton began to notice something else, too. If he stopped to listen at a door before going through it, he could make a guess as to what room lay behind it. The parlor, full of clocks, was the easiest one. But each room, he found, had a sort of voice. The music room's old house creaks sometimes came with accompanying tones, but out of tune, as if the instruments were settling as well. The solarium had a rattle of loose glass panes. The swinging door in the kitchen creaked on its hinges, moving with shifting air currents. Between hearing those sounds and knowing what types of doors each room had, Panton was able to predict with increasing accuracy which room he'd be walking into, provided it was one he'd already visited. Listening to the house and keeping detailed notes helped him navigate, or at least anticipate where the house was likely to take him. But Panton never did make sense of how time passed in that place. Still, time was passing, and he began to feel the effects of exhaustion and nerves. For a long time, though, as the night wore on, the constant strangeness kept him awake and alert, which was good, because sometimes there were unlikely accidents. In the taxidermy salon, just as Panton was opening a firearms closet of burnished wood, a mounted head fell off the wall, and only the open closet door saved him from being skewered by a spiraling antelope horn. In the music room, a wire in the open-topped grand piano snapped and whipped out with the discordant bloing. It missed lashing him right across the neck, only because he happened just then to be holding up his lantern for a better look at an unfamiliar brass instrument on a nearby chair. The impact, when the wire hit the metal edge of the light, was enough to send a crack snaking through the glass on one side. Only once in all the rooms he explored did he find anything that wouldn't open easily at a touch. A terrarium shaped like a small glass church that he discovered in the clock parlor, in which a little porcelain rabbit wearing a clerical collar and clutching a tiny glass bauble in its paws crouched among a collection of sad-looking flora. When he couldn't raise the lid, Panton lifted the terrarium carefully from the mantel and set it on a coffee table. He touched the streaked key in his pack, but there was no lock holding the delicate glass structure closed. Just a rusty hasp at one roof edge. Panton took out the peddler's tools and carefully worked a small screwdriver between the rusted bits until he felt the hasp give. He lifted the lid and peered down into exactly the same scene he'd seen through the dusty glass from the outside, though now he could see that the glass bauble contained a single flower woven of hair, and the plants, through some miracle of glass and humidity, looked like they might still be clinging to life. He opened his canteen and poured a trickle of water into the soil at the bottom of the terrarium, then closed the lid. The minute bell in the glass belfry chimed once as he put the little church back into its place. Not long after that, Panton found the map room. He was in the hallway, having just turned away from the narrow staircase for the umpteenth time, and was about to step out into the foyer. The room through the right-hand arch had changed again, and although he couldn't make out the source, there was light in that room, enough to lie tantalizingly across part of a strange chest with an assortment of drawers of various shapes and sizes, and to glance along one edge of a framed map on the wall above a leather chair just right for curling up in to take a very short catnap. The room called. The light all but beckoned. He stepped out of the hallway and into the foyer, and the house dumped him right back into the hallway, as if the entire world around him had pivoted 180 degrees. Penton turned and tried to go through again, and the same thing happened. He grabbed unsteadily at the wall for a moment before trying once more to leave the corridor, but the second his foot stepped across the threshold, the house shifted again. For whatever reason, it did not want him going into the room with the chair and the map. He tried for a few more minutes to find a way to it, despite the house's efforts to keep him out. The map room had a doorless arch, so he consulted his notebooks and tried every open entry he could find. But the house just kept throwing the narrow staircase at him, over and over, the one with the light at the top, which had not at first seemed like it could possibly fit where it was without running into the curved foyer stair. Evidently, the house had decided it was time for him to climb these particular steps, so although he longed for the welcoming light of the map room, Penton went up. He emerged on a landing where a bare bulb in a wall sconce threw dim bluish light into a cramped hallway with a green baize door midway down its length. Penton opened the door and looked out into a wide gallery with a red carpet. A carved marble balustrade ran the length of the gallery on the other side, broken only by the opening that marked the top of the grand foyer staircase. From where he stood, Penton could see a little way into each of the rooms below. The room with the map on the wall was still there, with its warm, glowing, come-this-way light. From that angle, the top of the cabinet was visible. Upon it sat a collection of globes in varying sizes, and a single, partly unrolled chart that showed blue water. Abruptly, the green baize door swung shut, whacking him right in the nose and flinging him back against the wall of the corridor lit by the flickering bluish bulb. When he shoved it open again, the red-floored gallery was gone, replaced by a different one with a blue carpet. Instead of looking down into the foyer, this gallery overlooked the solarium through a wall of green-tinged, many-paned windows. Penton crept across the space, held up his lantern, and looked through the glass. The bird from the cuckoo clock fluttered past on the other side, singing. The boy didn't know it, but the house had done him a kindness, just as it had when it had refused to let him into the foyer once the map room had appeared. Possibly, this was the influence of the parlor, where Panton's own act of kindness in watering the terrarium had not gone unnoticed. But what is certain is that the gallery where the curved stair landed was one of those spaces within the house that had a tendency toward violence. What looked like a russet and red paisley pattern in the carpet was actually an array of bloodstains of varying ages that had dried to a range of rusty tones. It wasn't a very imaginative space. It was home to a collection of grudge-holding suits of armor, carrying a variety of edged weapons, most of which were a bit anachronistic for the armor they'd been paired with. But those weapons had impossibly sharp edges, and the suits moved preternaturally fast for collections of plate metal. In fact, the only more vicious space in the house on Felwool was the map room, which used its enchanting light as an anglerfish uses its lure. And now, of course, Panton could think of nothing but getting to that very room, with its tantalizing cabinet full of drawers, and that light that made each of the globes atop the cabinet seem to wear a sort of halo. And logically, it seemed that the shortest way there would be through the red...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.